I see that the direct individuals were back at 3 1/4 minutes. The socializers are back at 6 1/4. We're still dragging some in. Now, I could see it in your eyes. All that dancing and that mind candy that David was throwing at you. You weren't prepared to hear about recruitment, something serious. So now we're ready. All right. Yesterday, we established a couple of things. First and foremost, flat is not a business model, right? You have to deliver growth. So your job security as leaders in this business is what? Continued new business growth. But in order to have new business growth, to make it a part of your culture, you have to have what? The right team, right? And the right team comes with recruiting the right stars. Because let's face it, as you look at your team now, there are going to be ebbs and flows, there are going to be changes. When expectation turns to hope, it's time to make a change. You may have to make a decision to free somebody for some better opportunities elsewhere, more suited. And I think between Roxanne and between David, you got a lot of different ways you can fire somebody now. Right? So, let's see if you can help me here. A little guessing game. See if you can help me fill in this sentence that I hear more often than any other sentence when I travel from you in this room. I can't find, where am I headed? Good people. Oh, you guys are looking ahead. See, you got this, right? I can't find good people. Does this keep you awake? You know, there's a long way to go from I can't find good people to want to join our team. I know there is immense blood, sweat, tears, prospecting, professional stalking, whatever it takes to get from I can't find good people to do you want to join our team. There's a wasteland here, and I want to address that today. So by the end of the discussion this morning, in the next 40, 45 minutes, hopefully, I'm confident, not hopefully, I'm confident you're going to have some clarity in where you need to go to find and recruit stars, okay? But you got to take action. Let's get started. What's our biggest issue? Anyone care to hazard a guess? The biggest issue is this. You don't act until you have a need. Right? I was speaking with someone this morning who said, well, Friday I had 7 AEs. As of today, I have 6. How are you going to fill that spot? I would say the best manager motto is ABL. Always be looking. ABL, always be looking. So if you're a manager that was always looking, you really don't lose a lot of traction, a lot of sleep, a lot of, quite honestly, mental anguish as a result of one of your AEs leaving while you're gone, because you've got a plan, you've got a backup. We'll dig a little deeper into that later. But let me ask you a question from the audience. Does anyone care to share where you're finding these people? Do you have a success story about the latest recruitment star that you found? Cellular company. Actually, let me have a... Hey, Tony, I'm going to use this mic. Is that all right? Hook me up right here. Brad, you said cellular company. Explain that a little bit.
Well, first of all, they're good at technology. They're not afraid of it. So as we bring them into the digital space, it's something they're just, you know, they just know about. And some of it, they're bringing, you know, their knowledge to our staff.
Excellent. Excellent. As I'm standing here looking at Brad, I'm also reminded of a conversation that I had with Mark when he arrived, and we were talking about hiring car sales folks. Give me some lines on that. Why do you think that's important?
Well, the guys work 7 days a week. Definitely are used to putting closing phrases together, and they're not afraid of the hustle, and they understand that to get ahead, they've got to be persistent and tenacious. So,
excellent. Thank you for that. Commission-based, 7 days a week. They aren't afraid to put in the hours. They know what it takes. In Brad's scenario, they aren't afraid of technology. They've been exposed to it. They like the new stuff. Where else? Go ahead.
Hi, Shondell Wilson. I'm with an ABC affiliate in Washington State. I just hired two people from the newspaper, and they have been exceptional hires because they were way ahead of the curve on digital in the newspaper industry. They also called on people that were non-traditional spot advertisers a lot, because there are people that always just went to the newspaper that made the TV reps, never even considered a category, that are now brand new categories, especially in the healthcare industry and a lot of the vertical that Jim was talking about.
Fabulous.
And they've been excellent hires.
Fabulous. Newspaper and radio right now hurting. Great opportunities there. There was one hand over here. I'll take one more. Newspaper as well? Excellent. Thank you for that. You know, it sounds like some of the folks in the room, which I'm not surprised, because what? You're the best of the best of the best, right? You're the smartest at what you do. You're starting to define your what, your zero basing, and you're going out and finding the who. So we're going to talk a little bit about the who, but let me go backwards for you here. Let me remind you of zero basing, the what. So we did an exercise where you wrote out the what that you need on your team. Remember, not unlike a baseball GM where I need a shortstop, or I need a relief pitcher, I need a batter, a cleanup person, right? On your team, what do you need? I need four new business prospectors. I need a retail person. I need an auto person. So you've zero-based your staff. So let's talk about the who. That's where the success profile comes into play. In your workbooks, we have a section there for success profile. And we ask you to think about your three best hires, the three best at that position, some of the traits that are listed there. What I'd like you to do, I'm going to kind of throw a spin at you here. I'd like you to go back to the what process. What do you need on your team? Without regard for the personalities, right? And then I want you to plug into the what, the who's. What are the traits the who's need in order to be plugged into the what on your team? You follow me? Sounds like a Dr. Seuss book, doesn't it? Okay, let's take a few minutes and do that. I really want you to be able to go back to your home markets and you have an idea of your what and then the who that goes into your what. Take some time. And then I'm going to ask for some input, please. Does anyone care to share your what's? I need four account executives. I need new business prospectors. I need... Kelly? See, when you look me in the eye, that's when you get picked.
Yeah. I guess when it comes to the success profile, I have a staff right now of in the 30s to mm-hmm. mid-40s. Mm-hmm. That seems to be working well. I do have a couple of transactional people that are a little older, but I guess I'm not sure, you know.
So when you're looking at your team, you say you've got a couple of transactional people. What is your what? What does your team look like? So do you have some new business folks you want? You want a couple of transactional people? Good.
I have seven people on my staff, and out of those seven people, I have two that are transactional, and the rest are all new business and local development.
Love it. Excellent.
Mm-hmm. My new business individuals are booking anywhere from 20 to 30,000 a month in new business.
Wow.
Individually.
Wow.
So our main focus and drive is new business, and it seems to be working for us. So, but it is a primary focus every single day.
So when you look at the success profile, those new business, those cultivators, mm-hmm. what kind of traits are we seeing? What kind of words are described?
They need to be adaptable. I think that's huge. They need to be driven. They need to be well organized so that they can plan and prepare each day. They need to be able to go out and cold call and be okay with it. They need to be assertive, good communication skills, presentation skills. I mean, they need to be true professionals.
Excellent.
But the part that is difficult to find are the things that you can't train, and that's the enthusiasm, the energy. And so when I'm interviewing, that's really what I look for is chemistry and personality traits, because the rest is trainable.
You've stumbled onto something very good there, very astute. You're hiring for personality. You can train them, but you're hiring for personality. What is the personality fit? That kind of plays back into Terry Owens and his ecosystem. You know, what do I need? Okay? Anyone else? Got one in the back? Yes, sir. You?
Well, when the... When I got turned on to this idea of the success profile, one of the interesting things about this was I came to the realization about a station that I was involved in that we'd had a very high failure rate on people we hired for their first jobs. Like 80%. And what I used the success profile for was to basically not even interview people when I was betting against the house. Because if we had that many people who were who we hired who didn't, and it wasn't that they failed, but they went away in a year, or you know, you never really got the ROI that you deserved from all the time you spent on them, that we just stopped interviewing those people and just said, you know what, this is a losing proposition for us because our success rate is just anemic. So, and then the other thing that I got turned on to about from another consultant was sometimes if you look at that profile, you'll realize. You know, people who, like my best AEs went to a state college, not to a private school. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean that the private schools are bad. It's just that maybe that was a group that wasn't used to fighting or scrapping or whatever. And I don't know. So those are the kinds of things that I learned in that whole exercise. It was really
just
good.
Just establishing commonalities. You know, and Kelly and Jim both said there, we don't want to waste a lot of time. The Harvard Business Review says when hiring, first you want to test and then you interview. And I know I've spoken about tests before and I continue to push that issue because I was a gut guy. I relied on my gut. I didn't need a test. Well, the reality is today, if you're going to test, you don't wait until you narrow them down. If you identify somebody, you want to test early in the cycle because you don't want to chase them for a number of weeks or months or go through the whole process and then the very last thing is the test. We're doing it backwards. Okay, now you've passed four interviews. The only final step you got to do is we're going to send you a personality profile test. And now you've wasted all that time. What's that, Kelly? Yes, absolutely. Kelly makes the point of professional interviewers. Yesterday I said, how many people lie when they're getting a job? Well, your gut may not pick up that lie. However, a test will pick up that lie. So let me tell you what to look for. And it doesn't matter if you're using an E3, a PXT, a disc graph, whatever the case is in your testing, there's some psychological pieces here that I want you to pick up on there. I'm going to give you five today that you want to look for. And when you look at your success profile of the individuals that you're describing that you want on your team, look for some of these descriptors. So if you're testing under the category proactivity, you want a high number in proactivity. Now, these folks are self-motivated. You can point, I want you to go east, west, whatever it is, and they're going to take off, right? They're focused on the end result. These are your hardest workers on the team. These are the Sherpas, reliable. They may not be number one all the time. They certainly aren't going to be last all the time. They're going to be middle of the road to high developers for you. Proactivity. Aggression, sometimes we look at aggression as a negative. Aggression, we're looking for a high score in aggression. This is someone who is urgent. They want to get to the end result as quickly as possible. And oh, bonus, the closing is the win. Do you have those folks that the win for them is actually getting the appointment and then they're done? Right? They work so hard to get the appointment, they go in, they do the presentation, they don't ask for the close. Well, folks who score high in aggression, they're all about closing. That's the win for them. And as a result, they are highly competitive. You put out a contest for the staff, these folks are going to kill themselves to win it every time. And then they're going to walk down the hallway and they're going to say, 7 quarters in a row, I've been number one, baby. And then you change the rules on them and they're going to go, whoa, whoa, whoa. What's this mean? They want to know. They aren't going to be upset. They want to know exactly what it means because they're that competitive. They want to finish first again. Self-control. Kind of like golf, we're looking for a lower score in self-control. And again, these psychological profile names may be different by the test, but the descriptors are consistent. This is what you're looking for, right? Self-control. These are the charismatic folks. These are the folks who warm up. These are the folks at a 300-person cocktail party. When you walk up to them, you feel like you're the only two folks in the room. They're that engaging. What do we need out of sales folks? We need a fast warm-up, right? We need differentiators. We need them to be able to connect when other competitors are walking in going, you want to buy this thing? You want to buy this? I got two of these. It ends Friday. You want to buy this? No. A warm-up, a personality. That's what we're looking for. They have a quick people connection, and instant gratification is their motive. They like to be liked. and they're going to do everything they can to make sure that you're happy with the service. Creativity, high scores in creativity in this. These are the folks, to use a cliche, out of the box. They're always asking, why not? Sometimes they'll come in and challenge you as a manager and say, gee, why do we do it this way? It's not confrontational. They're just trying to put the stuff together to figure out, is this the right thing or is it the wrong thing? Why are we doing it this way? Why can't we do it a different way? And as a result of their curiosity for why not, they handle objections extremely well. And then lastly, in the five things you want to look for when you're testing folks, matching it up with your gut, is critical thinking, a high score in critical thinking. These are the folks who are calculating. They're looking at the presentations. They're looking for the holes. Where is this going to break down? Where is something going to go wrong, if anything? It's not a Chicken Little scenario. It's a professional approach to say, okay, wait a minute. Does this address the need? That's what they're looking for. And as a result, these are the absolute best individuals at covering objections because they've already thought about what the objections are. Now, let me ask you the question. How cool would it be to have a team full of folks like that based on those descriptors? Do you have some of those descriptions in your success profile? The urgency, the want to close, the win, the quick warm-up? Those are the folks we're looking for, right? I mentioned this at the outset. Our biggest issue is we wait until we have a need, and then we go out and try to find somebody. When we say recruiting tips, I would say this is a recruiting must-do. Don't wait for the opening. Are you familiar with the term build a bench? In a soccer game here, somebody goes down with a knee issue. We got somebody to roll in and pick them up right away. Somebody to help the team immediately. In your world, the best managers always know who the next great hire is going to be because you are building a bench. Let me walk through a scenario. You're in your office. All heck is breaking loose. You got no time for anything. I'm going to show you how to shore that up tomorrow in time management for leadership, Steve. No time for anything, right? The most inconvenient time, an AE walks in, you can see it on their face. I'm sorry to tell you, I've got to resign. You get this flash of anxiety, right? Think about how you feel if you have someone in the wings and the AE comes in and says, I got to tell you, I'm going to resign. You go, okay, I'll help you pack, right? Because the faster you can get a quality rear end into the seat, the more credibility you have inside the station, and everybody on the team goes, this one's not messing around. This one's not messing around. I better watch myself. I better get this done. They're going to appreciate, as we determined yesterday, because it's whose responsibility to put the best people in the room? You. And the AEs are holding you accountable. So you want to have a line of folks. You know who your next hire is going to be in that scenario. I'll tell you, my career, I knew it took me 3 years for one individual. When I came back into the market, and I knew, and we had lunch. There was a production gentleman in the market. I had lunch with him. I said, I know, you know, your production's been your life, but I think you'd be a great sales guy. If you ever want to come to the dark side, make a step over, give me a call at a competing station. That was 2 years later. You identify them, line them up, and then you've got all the leverage in the world, right? You ever go to clients and ask for AEs? Here's the mistake I bet you're making. So you go to the car dealer and you say, hey, do you know anyone that would be good as an account executive for our station? And what are they going to say? Yeah, you know, my son is just graduating college, and he's a journalism major, but, you know, he'd like media. Now, what have you done? You have created a situation that you did not want to deal with, right? Well, my first response would be, if he's so good, why don't you hire him to sell cars? Truly, right? Here's what you got to do. You reverse your questioning. Instead of saying, do you know anyone, you say, who is the absolute best rep calling on you? Who is the absolute best vendor? And notice I'm not saying media, because don't forget there are a lot of salespeople calling on decision makers, not just you, right? So who is the absolute best rep? We can agree that if somebody can sell, and they're good at what they do in terms of selling, they got the basics, we can train in media. So who's the absolute best rep? And that also lends itself to, I'm looking for a little bit of experience. I'm not looking for, to Jim's point, hiring first-time folks. Sometimes that's the biggest fail, the biggest washout. And then my next immediate question is, hey, Bob, if that's the absolute best rep you know, the best rep calling on you, why haven't you hired him? And then you be quiet and listen. The why haven't you hired them is important, because what you want to say is, what's the bad thing? What's the downside? What's the good stuff about them? Let it be an open-ended question. Why haven't you hired him? And then they're going to say, you know, there's just sometimes that I don't think he could sell whatever we've got out there. Or there are sometimes, you know, he doesn't seem to call me until 11 o'clock, so I'm not sure that he gets up too early and he goes to work early enough. So the natural stuff will come out, and you can make your decision from there. Make sense so far? You got to know your competition, because stealing is permitted and highly encouraged. It is entirely too competitive to not know your competition. You should have right now on the bulletin boards in your offices a chart with every single media outlet. And it should have managers' names, it should have account executive names, and in a file, you should have somewhere the accounts that are tied to those AEs in those stations. Do you have it? No, we got to get there. You got to get there. It is so easy to figure out who's calling on what. You could pretty much figure out 70% of an account list on the competition tied to the AE as a result of understanding the buys and sells and the share stuff that comes in. If you have that, that is gold. To get off the recruiting for just a second, excuse me. If you maintain that list and one of the account executives leaves your competitor, the first thing I'm doing as a manager is flooding every single one of their clients. Because change is painful. Oh my gosh, Bill has taken care of me for 5 years and he's leaving. Come here, let me put my arm around you. I'll take care of you. Right? That's what you got to do. That's the thinking. That's the run. That's why it's so important to maintain this list. So you keep a chart of all your competitors. You find out who is eating your lunch. Who is giving you fits. You know the buys are coming in, then the AE comes struggling in. Well, I thought we were going to get 30%. We only got 20%. Looks like Mary put it to us again. Who are those folks? And then you need to go after them. Call someone who left the station. Let's say for whatever reason, a gentleman's wife gets reassigned in another market, so he's got to quit the TV station. Give him a call on the way out of town and say, hey, I heard you're going to be moving on. Congratulations to you and your wife, but let me ask you a quick question. Is there anyone at the station you just left that really impressed you? Is there anyone that maybe is not being recognized for their talents right now that you think is going to be a breakout star? Can you do that? Absolutely. All right, let's talk about identifying cash cows in your marketplace. Cash cow. Here's the deal. There are haymakers sitting across the street from you. And you know who they are. You know their names. There are folks who are drumming it up. There are people who are banging down doors that your AEs can't even touch. So instead of having fits and dreaming about getting beaten all the time and how you're going to make up this money, why don't you get the cash cow on your team? Right? I would suggest when you identify who they are, all out professional stalking. You're going to chase them and sell them just as hard as you would the biggest new business for the biggest bonus in your life. It's that simple. Some of you say, well, that's a little prideful. I don't know if I can. Hey, you are responsible for building the absolute best team, and I promise you, if you build the absolute best team, your life becomes easy. It snowballs. Right? Some of you are doing that right now. Here, so you have a discreet coffee or a meal back in the corner where the market can't see you. You just introduce yourself and say, I'm hearing some great things about you. I like what you're doing. I'm seeing that you're putting it to us on occasion. Just wanted to explore the opportunity that maybe we might be able to make an agreement at some point. You're going to follow up with thank you notes. You're going to send them to their house. how about you use your phone and you do a little video thank you? Maybe you do a little video update and text it to them after you saw them 6 months later. You know, you're just making deposits over time. And you're saying, hey, just thinking about you, wanted you to see our new news set. We just upgraded a lot of capital in this building. We're going to sell the daylights out of it. Now might be a good time for you to come out and take a tour. Little video, right? Birthday cards. Congratulations on a buy. Hey, Mary, I saw you got 40% on that buy. Whew, you put it to us. Can't wait until you're over on our team and you're doing the same thing for us. What did I do there? The assumptive close. Now we begin to talk as we're building a relationship, the assumptive. We're making it, you're on our team. You got to be on the lookout for deposit opportunities, just as you would going after the biggest whale client. At some point, this is going to be your next home. It's just a matter of timing. And you really have to feel like that, and you really have to come across with that statement. So let me ask you a question. How long do you pursue the cash cow? How long does the average account executive, how many calls do they make on a business before they give up? Less than three. We want that immediate gratification, right? In this scenario, how long do you pursue the cash cow? Would you believe 6.5 years? I'm not kidding you. I was in the middle of writing content. Writing this exact discussion we're having right now. And the heavens opened up and my phone rang. And I'm talking to a vice president who will go nameless in one of the corporate staffs. And he was telling me about the new hire he just picked up. And I said, walk it through for me. What happened? Because that name sounds familiar to me. He said, John, 6.5 years ago, I contacted this manager. And I said, would you like to come over to us? Come from across the street, come over to us. We came to an agreement. The manager told his boss, I'm leaving you. The boss said, no, I can't. You can't leave me. I'm going to fly in tomorrow. Don't leave. The boss came in, gave this manager a 50% base pay raise. You're that important to me. I need to compensate you. Obviously, the VP at the corporate staff was a little disappointed by that. But over time, they talked from time to time. They became friendly. And then in November of last year, the VP called the manager and said, is now a good time to talk? Which was an indication that I'm not asking about the family. Well, through discussions, they decided now is good timing for both of us. The manager resigned, and just before the resignation, he called the VP of corporate and said, I'm sorry to kind of muddy the waters here, but we're in a difficult situation at our company right now. Would it be okay if I were to bring a local sales manager and our highest billing new business AE with me? 6.5 years, and we just hit the trifecta jackpot. How cool is that? So don't give up on your pursuit, because if you're trying to build the biggest and best staff possible, and you've identified these folks, you should stop at no cost to bring them in. It's that simple. But always remember this from that lesson. I'll use this over and over and over. The VP, who shall go under protection, he said to me, John, what I learned from this experience is, if there is a round one, there is likely going to be a round two. So you always get a second chance. But understand this, it's a two-way street. So if your culture is not one that cultivates and makes people happy and allows opportunity for growth, and at 70% socializers, you know, has a little fun tied in, then there may be a round two with your folks from across the street. To be fair, right? Am I making sense? Good. Strength in numbers. It doesn't hurt to have testimonials and folks other than you calling those future prospects. Have your department heads call. Have your AEs while they're out and about say hello. You have AEs, you have cheerleaders who'll do that. Do you offer a bounty to your folks? Anyone here, by show of hands, do you offer money if they help hire somebody? Yeah? It's usually, look, I'll give you, you know, $250 now when the person gets hired. They're still with me a year later, I'll give you another $250. Kind of gets the full station involved. So I recognize there's a difference in going after a cash cow and looking just for talent, whether it be an entry-level person or whether it be a person you saw in another retail or another job. We've already discussed some of the places you're finding, but you know, look around. Are we calling colleges? Are we going to find them in the insurance business? Are we going to find these folks who have the similar traits that you've written down in your success profile? Are we going to find them in any of these businesses? A teacher? Retail? Car dealers? Banking? Maybe the approach is a little different. It's more of an attack. Do you use classifieds? Do you use word of mouth? Your social media? Just on the lookout, period? Yeah, every one of those. By the way, according to smartrecruiters.com, these are the hottest places to find employees right now when it comes to social media and it comes to internet advertising. Oh, I love the folks who are pulling out their phones and taking that picture. These are the people who are going to take your people. Oh, that was high end. Right? You're using this stuff? John, I hear you. I hear everything you're saying. I got you. I can pursue the cash cow. I can pursue these folks. But you know what? I can't afford them. You can't not afford them. How can you not? You can't not afford them. What am I trying to say? You got to pay them. You got to bring them in. Here's what's going on. If you go to Trader Joe's, Trader Joe's is paying 2 times what their competitors are paying. They're paying folks who are not managers $40,000 to $60,000. $40,000 to $60,000. I don't know about you, but when I became an account executive in television and I had radio experience, my offer was a base guarantee, the equivalent of $24,000 a year, and it was a 3-month guarantee. What is that? $2,000 a month. Oof. And I know, as I travel the country, there are still stations out there who are saying, well, we'll give you a $30,000 guarantee, and after the 3rd month, you're straight commission. Costco is paying 40% more than the competition. Pizza delivery drivers are driving Mercedes, BMWs, Audis with brand new tags. I'm not making these pictures up. This is what I see on the road. So that's what you're up against. What's that? If I'm a dad and you're putting pizza miles in that stink in my new car, I got a problem. You can put all the air fresheners in the world, but you're getting hot pepperoni out of that new Audi. All right. Do you use classifieds? Do you use print? I'm going to tell you, I think there's still value in paper for this reason. A lot of the paper now, because they're suffering, and thank you, you found some reps from newspaper we talked about. Because they're suffering, they will throw in a suite of social media, Monster, all the other social, a lot of social media as we told you. So you can go to a newspaper and buy a classified, but yet at the same time get all the social media for less than it would take to buy each one of the individual social medias. Does that make sense? So classified is still a nice opportunity. And certainly, TV news checks, spots and dots, cable spots, all of those publications are good locations for your stuff. What's the purpose of your one ad? What's the purpose of your classified? Well, we're always out there looking for the perfect prospect, right? But the purpose is to what? Generate some action to get folks to see the ad in order to apply for the job. But can I tell you something? I want to be totally honest here. I don't think you know me well enough by now. I don't pull punches. And I'm very aggravated by this, so if my tone changes, I apologize. As an industry, our classifieds, our want ads absolutely suck. They're horrid. They offer nothing. Nothing. Zero. Zilch. They suck. You got to rewrite every one of your offers. Here's what I think. This is a John Hannon speculation. I think because you're waiting till the last second when somebody exits the door and you don't know who the next hire is going to be, now you're up against the wall. We got to get an ad out. What's the ad we ran last time? Mr. and Mrs. Local Sales Assistant. Where's that ad that we ran last time at the paper? All right, run that thing for another 2 weeks. Why? I can't find good people. Let me show you what I'm seeing out there. It just, it makes me sick. Sick. We're looking for a digital account executive. The DAE has a passion for digital. You got to uncover digital media, regional, digital agencies, digital account executive, report the digital sales director. What? That sucks. It's terrible. You laugh, but some of you in this room are doing it. We're looking for a digital manager. You oversee the operations, you interact with clients, you maximize digital revenue, you make sales calls, you manage inventory. Good golly, sign me up. Not. Come on. You got to grow revenue as an AE. You got to see local advertisers as an agency. You got to have 5+ years of experience. You got a BA, no BS, marketing. Guys, if you look at the long toilet paper roll list in TV news check today on the internet, you'll see 9.9 out of 10 ads look like this. I can't find good people. It's horrid. Right now, today, this room with the smartest folks in the industry, we need to make a change. We need to start looking at our ads and spice them up. Let me show you some things here. Pat Norris, who you're going to hear from later today, our automotive expert at Station, reached out to him and said, I need a little help with my classifieds. What can I do? Pat said, hey, you ever want to get in the TV? We're looking for two folks. You sell jewelry, clothing, auto, insurance, anything to decision makers. We want to talk to you. Realistic income is $50,000 to $60,000. Our top earners are over 100. Now, some of you, I know it just happened. I heard it. Some of you are going, well, I can't advertise how much you're going to make. Why? Look what happens here. You advertise it, and the AEs are going, well, I'm not making 100 grand. No, because you aren't selling. But if I hire someone who sells, they're going to make 100 grand. Right? It's a little inside push. Don't be afraid. What you're doing right now isn't working, or we wouldn't be having this conversation. So try it. Put the money out there. Don't make them call. Do you ever get sucked into a commercial, an offer, and they don't tell you how much it is? And then you don't want to call because you don't know how much it is. And then it kind of passes. Tell them how much they're going to get. Oh, pictures. Oh. Good golly. Do we say no cell phones today? All right, you guys got it? Got it? All right, let's move. So here we go. Pat offered up. You get training salary, medical, vacation, lots of benefits. We give you support. We give you training second to none. We like to have fun. 70% of the crowd are what? You got to offer fun. We'd like to have, oh my goodness, this company likes to have fun. Well, this company says I have 5+ years experience and I'm going to call and I got to make budgets and I got to report to the... No. Let me show you some of my favorites. Let me show you some that I've been collecting over the course of time that I've gotten excited about. Here we are in Milwaukee. By the way, the ones that I showed you previously, obviously I took out the names to protect the guilty. Okay? But these I'm leaving the names in because I'm proud of these stations. Here's Milwaukee. We got the candy store, baby. Number one rated news. We got local production with Real Milwaukee, Studio A, Fox 6 Blitz. Awesome sports with Packers, Brewers, NASCAR. Now, if I'm looking at that, I'm going, nice. I could sell that stuff. Let me in. Let's move on to Baton Rouge. Local sales manager, broadcasting and cable, says we're a blowtorch station with a sales team that leaves scorched earth in its wake. That is kick rear right there. That is a good one. Let me call those folks, right? Where's my Orlando folks? Orlando, right over here. Good. I love this. We're in Florida, right? Tired of digging out of the snow? We got warm weathers, beautiful beaches, theme parks, no state income tax. I thought that was pretty good. That's a good one, right? Well, as Dave Riva sometimes will tend to do, he'll throw out a trump card. So I'm on my LinkedIn a couple weeks ago. Sorry, we didn't even talk about this. Is that all right? I'm on my LinkedIn a couple weeks ago, And this pops up from Dave. Dave is looking at business folks and saying, hey, if it's not you, do you know somebody? He's on a business site, LinkedIn. If it's not new, do you know somebody? Tell them about the opportunity we have. We have a bigger list. We have strong syndication, great prime programming. We have 5 hours of local news. Because some folks in this scenario would think, well, CW, you don't have news. Not the case. We're a powerhouse here. We've been number one in the country, one of the highest rated multiple times. We contract Jim Doyle and Associates, the absolute best training, sales training folks in the country. Is that in the ad? Oh, sorry. State-of-the-art sales training. You sold us short there, Dave. State-of-the-art sales training. And for you socializers, fun. Is that a cool ad? You get a free book for that, Dave. That's a cool ad. But even bigger, it was on LinkedIn. LinkedIn. Are you having success with Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter? Are you using it? You know, Facebook. Look at Facebook the end of the year. Look at the end of the quarter. Because this just happened recently when I said this to a station. You will see account executives, you will see station sites that will post, hey, I just won the President's Club Award. Hey, I just won the Ad Club Award for sales. And so I said, I'm talking with a manager in a market, and the manager said, did you see Susie won the award again across the street again? I said, yeah. What'd she say when you called to congratulate her? And the manager said, I didn't call. I said, well, did you send her a Facebook message? Something everyone doesn't see? No, I didn't think to do that. Susie was a 3-year award winner of their Top Gun, whatever you call it. But yet this manager across the street recognizes there's an award winner in the marketplace, and she sees it on Facebook, and she's not calling Susie. It boggles my mind. I can't find good people. They're right in front of you. You're going to trip over them. So put it on your personal, put it on the company Facebook. With LinkedIn, the biggest mistake you're making with LinkedIn is that you do not promote your company on your LinkedIn site. If you are a sales leader at a company, you need to have the company intertwined with your personal brand on the LinkedIn site so people are getting jazzed about what you had to offer at your place, right? So I had this great idea. Sometimes I come up with a great idea, at least I thought. And I'm thinking, wow, we have Instagram, Snapchat, Meerkat, Periscope, YouTube. You're familiar with these? All video roll, right? How cool would it be? Take your phone, put a little message out there. Hey, we're looking for new business folks. First year, realistically, you're doing your job, you're going to make 50 to 60 grand. Let me give you an inside tour of what the sales pit looks like. Here was us at our sales meeting the other day. Oh, wait, we just got a new news set. Oh, there's Billy, the meteorologist. Billy, tell these folks to send their resume to us. And then you take it and you post it. And then you favorite the hell out of it, and it gets picked up everywhere else, right? So I thought, great idea. Surely someone else has thought of that. I went to YouTube, not one. I'm embarrassed to say to you, not one broadcasting job offer on YouTube. That sickens me. The job offer I did find, where's Jimmy from Bright House? Jimmy, okay, here's our lone cable guy. If you want to buy drinks, buy this guy drinks tonight because he's taking a little bit of a brush from David Glickman, especially, was making fun of cable. I would never make fun of cable. And after you see this, you aren't going to make fun of cable either. The only presence about a job on YouTube was this from cable. Now, I don't normally play extended videos, but this is about 2 minutes long. And I need you to see it, because at the end of the video, what I'm going to hear is, you know what that is? Your chin hitting the table. Like, I cannot believe I missed this as a station.
In the world of broadcast, where one commercial may air in the entire tri-state area, at Comcast Spotlight, we have the opportunity to target by county to help our client reach the audience that would make sense. A typical day for me is I wake up early in the morning to get my kids ready for school. I jump in my car, and then from that point, it's go hard all day. I usually have about 15 minutes to prepare before our sales meeting begins at 9. And the big direction in our meetings is our focus on new business.
New business is everything.
We discuss what happened the week prior. We discuss what's going on in the current week and future weeks, what opportunities we have to sell our clients.
One in a million shot is still a chance, right? They're looking for answers as well. You need to be the next phone call they get. You need to be the next person they see. Let's get crazy.
When the sales meeting wraps up, I usually head back to my desk and start to formulate my plan for the remainder of the day. I'm usually out meeting with clients the majority of the day. Calling to see if you would be available for a quick meeting Wednesday or Friday morning. I am going to see if we can close a deal. No matter what level of account rep you are, it's our responsibility as salespeople to generate new business. Senior level salespeople have a different budget than entry level salespeople and people in between. Collectively, as a group, our office has a budget as well. And in the end, what's going to get us there is we work together as a group. It takes up to a year to close a good piece of business. It's a long sales process. When you close it, it feels great. Every now and then, if I'm in my office and I need to just break away, I'll jump to the local coffee shop and pick up some local magazines and flip to see any articles about local businesses that are coming into the community. When you meet with a business that hasn't advertised at all, my first goal is to learn about their business, to learn about their customers, to learn about what they're currently doing in their advertising, and I then go back, pull some research, create a great story, something that means something to them, something that will help them grow their business and reach the potential customers that they're looking to reach. In the end, we're doing our best to help our clients achieve their goal, and that's to grow their business. Should I do my happy dance now?
You want to know why folks are going to cable and not going to your stations? I don't know. By the way, did anyone write her name down? I'd call her. Hey, I see you're up there in Pennsylvania. I saw you walking in the snow. We're here in sunny Florida with no state tax. Would you like to come down? I got a list. Right? Am I making my point? If there's a tone this morning, I apologize, because it seems so simple, and I gotta tell you, it really is if you put it in traction. But this has to be a part of your schedule. This has to be a part of your DNA. It has to be a part of your calendar.
It should be a part of your pre-roll video.
Your pre-roll on your website? Absolutely. Anywhere you can get it, Kelly. Yes. How about the power of your own airwaves? There is no other mass medium in the world that has the reach of TV, right? So how about running commercials on your air saying we're looking for account executives? Unfortunately, on YouTube, there were no broadcasting commercials doing this. Let me tell you from my experience, even if I didn't need folks, I'd go into the local sales manager and say, hey, I need you to run an ad. But we're full up. I mean, we got a list. We know who we're hiring next. I don't care. I'm getting a feel in the air of a little complacency on the floor. So I need you to throw this on the air for about a week, put it in heavy rotation, say we're looking for AEs. I call that the sales boost effect. Watch how quickly all the AEs come running in the office going, are we hiring somebody? We very well may be. Why don't you tell me? What'd you write today? Right? The sales boost effect. Boy, you get resumes and you set everybody on fire at the station. It's that simple. So let me show you the only video that I could find that I'm assuming was on TV, because it looks like a TV commercial, but it was on Facebook. So, okay, kudos for throwing it on Facebook, but they didn't throw it on LinkedIn. They didn't throw it on YouTube. They didn't put it anywhere else. It was on Facebook. So I'm assuming it was on TV. Here we go.
There are jobs, then there are careers that are fulfilling, careers that give you an opportunity for great growth. WXTX Fox 54 is looking for a high-energy account executive full of passion for their career and for their clients. Join the team of professionals at WXTX Fox 54, selling the best shows on television, the most powerful brands in sports, and the area's number one local news at 7 and 10. For a career with great compensation and great benefits, email your resume to ccoldridge@wxtx.com.
Is anybody doing that? You're putting it everywhere besides TV? You're passing out to all the department heads? You're throwing up a link for all the staff and saying, hey, don't forget about the employee bounty. $500 if you help hire somebody. Here's how they need to match up. Send this link around. Post it. Can you do that? I can't find good people. It occurred to me, maybe, just maybe, we're looking at this wrong. Maybe, if you create an environment where people want to work, then this environment, ripe with stimulation and opportunity, cheerleaders on the team, buy-in, professional accountability, a commitment to training and betterment, celebration and fun, this environment, if you can create this environment, then maybe the I can't find good people goes away. Because at that point, I promise you, at that point, people are lined up outside your door. And it's not a matter of I can't find good people, it's a matter of which of the good people do I take. Make sense? Cool? Sue. All right. As we wind down just a little bit for the close. Man, that was intense. I'm sweating. You guys all right? I'm sorry. I don't want you to feel like you just saw the principal, but it infuriates me. They're out there, and I see so many folks leaving, and we got to grab them. We got to grab them for the future of the business. All right. I'm off my soapbox.